I do not have a label on my forehead that says, hey, Brendan Trukai coming. And maybe people don't know a person with who has had their head cracked a bit has some deficits other people don't have. It is just not obvious.
I had very, very thick bangs until I was 18, and then I got my eyebrow pierced because I was tired of feeling crappy about myself, you know, and I wanted something in this area of my face to kind of show off. And the next day I cut my bangs off, and that was like the beginning of me kind of figuring out how to deal with the way I look.
I can remember looking into the mirror and just looking, trying to look into the pools of my eyes to see if I could see somewhere down inside my soul, if I could recognize me, because I couldn't recognize me. I was totally a different person.
Confusion, disorientation, seizures maybe. I'm dealing with cognitive changes, personality changes, mood swings, depression. I'm dealing with balance, dizziness. I might really struggle with overstimulation. I might have to really get lots of accommodations. I might need to take breaks all the time. I'm going to get fatigued far too much. Things are going to just overwhelm me really easily. I'm going to need a lot of changes in my life. If you just start, and that's just a list that I, with a really impaired memory, just rattle off in no time.
My brain injury occurred 16 years ago, the result of a freak accident where a car jumped the curb and smashed a traffic sign against my head. This injury changed everything in my life and sent me on a journey I'm still on today, a journey to relearn what my brain can and can no longer do. It's a journey shared by millions of people who, like myself, have found their lives radically changed and often torn apart by a brain injury.
I was stabbed. I lost a lot of blood. And when you lose blood, you lose oxygen to the brain, and then all kinds of neurological deficits ensue, which in my case made me blind and talk funny.
Where is the water?
Back here.
Yeah, all right, right. Okay, so this light should come.
I have no shame about it. If I'm saying, meeting someone, hey Joe, I'm Dirk, I don't say, hey Joe, I'm brain injured. But if it becomes a germane issue in the course of a discussion or a plan, I will mention that.
So it's just a straight line.
That when the bark is overhead.
Right, yeah. Not the underground one.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
You there?
Yeah. I have a vague recollection of it being totally black. billows of black smoke and not being able to see anything. But I don't know if that was the fire or if that was the coma after the fire. You know, I got to the front door, and the fireman, what I'm told, is hatcheted down the front door and burst it down on top of me and ran in. You know, and by then things were, cinders were falling and boards were falling and stuff like that.
A burning house fell on you, essentially.
Yeah.
And also, was it because of maybe the smoke too, like an oxygen?
Yeah,
I had. The brain too?
Yeah. So they actually didn't think I was going to make it. They thought I was going to die. I was in the intensive care for a long time. I can remember complaining about how the back of my head hurt, you know, and how numb my head was. And I can remember being in a bed in the cardiac unit with some other woman that was in there for I don't know what and complaining. And about, you know, my head hurting and different things, and they weren't paying any attention to me. And I can remember that doctor saying, you know, you're doing fine to the lady next to me. You're not like her, or something like that. And I assumed that he meant that I was crazy.
Nani's brain injury occurred over 25 years ago. During her stay in the hospital, Nani wasn't diagnosed with a brain injury, and it's still not uncommon for this to happen. Without support from her family or friends, Nani found herself living on the street.
I would sleep in parks or in doorways. For years, I had, you know, just like one pair of pants and a couple of t-shirts and one pair of one set of underwear.
One of the things that's most frustrating that I lost since the accident is the verbal ability. You know, a lot of times I can be talking and I can't think of a lot of words, you know. And so other people have to supply it, you know. And I really used to banter verbally with people a lot. And now I'm not quick enough, you know, to do that. I can't keep track of things enough to do that, you know, once in a while.
For about 10 years after my injury, I didn't talk to many other brain injury survivors. Then in 2000, I heard of a local support group for what are called higher functioning survivors. Fortunately today, there are quite a few brain injury support groups around the country. The one I belong to, the East Bay Brain Injury Support Group, meets in a public library.
I don't know how someone can have a brain injury and not have a partner and survive. Because you just lose so much, you don't know what's going on. You need someone to lean on to be your advocate and support system and your better half of your memory. Because you have to go to all these doctors and they say, well, how's it been since last month? And,
I've had my share of grieving, and I don't know that we ever get, I have not gotten over it. I get really frustrated lots of times that people don't take the time to accommodate my situation, both on a physical and on an emotional brain injury kind of level.
It's certainly encouraging to be in touch with other brain injury survivors. It was my experience with this group and the friends I made here that inspired me to make this documentary in the hope of ending the silence about brain injury.
Union in that respect. Memory is a major problem, professionally, academically, and whatnot. That's why I came upon what's now called a PDA, the local personal data assistant, where you can write down, copy your information down and have it at your disposal at a flash.
memory is just so difficult. I not only have one PDA, I have four PDAs, two tape recorders, and I still forget stuff. I'm fond of my friends who I have in the support group. I have been coming for years, and I don't think I could name the injuries that cause the TBIs of three of my friends. A bad memory. But I am grateful for their grace that they do not think ill of me for not being able to remember something about them. But how difficult this is in establishing new friendships if you cannot remember the personal data that of self-identification of another person.
Learn how to manage it. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. All the men frameworks.
Do you want to be in front, or should we run up to this one? The reason I wear a cap and glasses is because this visual and movement and all that stuff throws me off. So it's partly to not have to think, but also because I'm not really able to think well while traveling, especially on something. And then when get off at a station, of course it's busy and bustling and stuff, especially if it's unknown territory. Once I've done it once or twice with someone, that helps. But if it's somewhere I've never been before, it's just overwhelming. I mean, there's plenty of disabled people, that brain injury people that drive, and I can't because of the motion and mental fatigue and the stimuli. But then they have it's just my memory's not as bad as a lot of other people's. My fatigue and my mental fatigue and sensitivity to stimuli is my main deficit. But other people, I can stay focused longer until the fatigue, whereas other people are just always drifting completely and stuff, so.
16th Street, Mission Station.
28 when mine happened, and okay. A lot of the people, whether it be stroke or traumatic brain injury or whatever, there's definitely a before and after identity, and it's like, for 28 years I was this,
right,
and then this happened, and it takes 5, 10, however many years, right, to learn what you can and can't do, and then once you know that, it's like, okay, so how am I going to live the next 30 or 40 years of my life or whatever, and so there's that whole thing, but in your case, it's different.
This is who I am.
Exactly.
Right.
So it would be much more difficult for you to say, I used to do this and now I can't, so I do that.
Right.
So I'm just wondering, in terms of deficits, as they're called, just because they're called that, if there's right. anything that you, because I guess you would just have to see it in terms of what's normal, maybe,
well,
or what other people can do and you can, or I don't know, how do you look at that?
It's interesting. Like, honestly, like, I've been thinking about, you know, my life as it applies to, like, my head injury and the accident I had when I was 2, like, more lately, because I knew this was mm-hmm. coming up.
In the beginning, yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Hi, Cody.
I'm confused. Don't listen to me. I haven't had enough coffee.
There's not room for you at this line.
What? There's no room.
Okay,
because on this side, my when I was 2 years old, I got dragged by a horse and suffered a traumatic brain injury. I think I had, it was severe swelling of the frontal lobe, which is where I guess all your coordination and motor skills and like balance and things are stored. I wasn't expected to survive, and then when it became apparent that I was going to make it, no one really knew what my prognosis was going to be in terms of like normal life. And then it's like, okay, so I'm going to have all my intelligence, but walking, I had to relearn how to walk. I had to relearn everything.
It's better to do with the
I overcome. I've gone a lot farther, like in the world of like physical movement than anyone ever imagined I would have. And with training, like I've really come a long, long way. But like there are some things, like I'm just not gonna be a fabulous, amazing dancer.
Just if we can have both groups on this side, but maybe like with the space in between, which is what it'll be like when we're doing the minute long routine.
Okay, great.
So.
I've spent a lot of money trying to learn how to drive. And more frustrating than the car is the riding the bicycle, which I have kind of started to try to do. And it's, I can do it. I can, if someone starts me, I can go for a little while before, I haven't fallen yet. So I can go for a little while before I feel like I'm losing control and have to like stop, you know. I can't really start myself yet, and I haven't been out in a while because it puts me in this like psychologically horrible place where like I think it would be easier to learn to walk the tightrope than to ride the bicycle, because riding a bicycle is something that everybody is supposed to be able to do, you know, and like. And so that really...
Harvey's story is different from most others I've heard. Her injury was so early in life. In my case, it took months to get back on my feet and begin slowly learning what I was able to do after my injury. I haven't been able to hold a job in over 15 years, and I spend most of my time around the house and yard. In Harvey's case, she has no memory of her life before her injury. One key feature of brain injuries is that no two are alike. What works well for Harvey may not work well for anyone else. We can all learn a lot from each other, but my experiences will never be exactly like hers, and her experiences will never be exactly like mine.
Oh my God, I'm disabled and I'm oppressed.
If you have to struggle, it does something to you, you know, where it's like, yeah, I don't give a what anyone thinks. I'm going to be who I am, and I'm not going to compromise, you know, if I want to do what I want to do. And not everybody has that, like you only do that if you have to, you know. And I guess it was either sink or swim, you know, and I learned how to swim.
Your forgotten stepson.
The middle finger, index. When you get to the thumb, put the thumb on the inside and squeeze. Feel that tension building. Inhale, squeeze. Exhale and release. There. Okay.
Where you are now in your current state, what type of things, how would you describe that?
Well, that is also a process of evolution. I, as many brain injured people, I'm not willing to say this is how I will be for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking that perhaps perhaps I will recapture my old brain, recapture my old abilities, and maybe even with the help of science or pharmaceuticals, well, how about, become even better. I mean,
are you better now than you were 5 years ago? Or
I'm better now than I was last week.
So let's have you on your stomach now, please. Just have to do all this stuff, but let me put this down for you. Bringing her head back over her shoulder. She's got arthritis of the thoracic spine and distress of the rib joints to the spine. She also has the stress pattern.
At what point do you realize, were you told or did you realize that you had a brain injury?
Like not until a long, long time after.
So like 10 years? Five years?
Maybe.
5, 10 years?
Yeah.
When did you finally begin rehab for brain injury?
Probably 1988.
So you're 8 years brain injured and out in the world wandering aimlessly?
Yeah. I just thought I was crazy. You know, and I remember I finally got enough nerve up to tell a psychiatrist, you know, and he said, you're not crazy. He said, that's part of your head injury.
That's the first time you had heard that.
Yeah, because I'd never told anybody what was going on with me. Everything was just fine, thanks.
You should write in there, Nautilus Bay, in the box.
8 years after her brain injury, Nani finally entered a cognitive rehab program at an Oakland community college.
Mm-hmm. You know, I had to know when the bus left, what time I had to be at the bus, what I had to do to get to the bus, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. If I missed the first bus, how
what
would I
were
get
my
here?
Options?
Yeah. And I think you taught me plan A, plan B, plan C, you know, and to like have them all, you know, in case I lost one, I could fall back on another one. And that really helped me get out of the house because I used to get lost when I would leave the house, mm-hmm. you know, and I remember it wasn't until I did.
I think after you injure your brain, there's often a kind of what I call fuzzy-mindedness that develops. There's a tendency to be a little more spacey or less focused.
I know that well.
A lot of the time, what people think of as a memory problem is related very much to their lack of focus and their distractibility. So we do a lot of work with that.
Cognitive rehabilitation teaches survivors different ways to negotiate the world around them. Simple everyday things taken for granted before an injury can become impossibly complicated when you can't remember things, aren't able to concentrate, or your understanding of the world no longer operates as it had before your injury. In programs like this one, survivors retrain their thinking. They identify areas where they have difficulties and learn strategies to work around them. For me, cognitive rehab was a cornerstone in being able to get back into my life after my injury. I'm always amazed when I hear of a survivor who hasn't yet had this kind of rehab. Truth is, classes like Becky's can make the difference between a survivor sinking or swimming.
We have to find the way out.
This is the first day I'll introduce this assignment called Get Me Out of Here. And you'll see it's a pretty complex program where they have to read maps, follow directions, write down very precise steps involved in accomplishing a task that's complex, and it's a good kind of simulation of the complexity of the real world, where you have a lot of things you have to keep together and keep organized and not drop critical pieces.
We had to think what is now I can't remember.
Right. This is an exercise itself, it sounds
like.
My fascination's always been, how do we know? Mm-hmm. How do we understand? Mm-hmm. And with an acquired injury, there's the history or the knowledge that I used to know this, or I used to understand this. And so we can be Sherlock Holmes and try and figure out what pieces are missing that you used to have, and see if we can kind of parse it back together again. Mm-hmm. But if you've never been able to perform this cognitive skill, it's a whole different kind of
ballgame. Is it more difficult, maybe, or is it not necessarily?
I'll say from this perspective, the acquired injury is harder because there's the sense of loss.
Mm. Yeah.
How do you think it's changed from the late 80s
since
I started? Yeah, I mean, just in any way that comes to mind.
I think people with head injuries are a lot more visible and out there doing things, stating their case, making themselves known in the world. I think there's some better awareness of what is a head injury, but I still don't think the general population or public really understands what someone says when they say, I've had a head injury.
Steps one at a time, and I know, and I'm capable of walking like a normal person.
How do you feel towards brain injury people? Do you feel like a bond or a connection, or do you feel not necessarily? Or some people don't want to hang out with other brain injury people. Some people seem to feel connected. I mean, I don't know. Do you think that there's something that links you?
Once again.
Okay.
Because there is a commonality of experience. Surely, I feel closer to brain-injured persons than I would to Hollywood starlet, for example.
Right.
And I do spend my time with brain-injured people, but unhappily, it's generally not a productive time.
You mean as a group or two people?
No, that one-on-one. I think you are less likely to hear how many angels dance on the head of a pin, or how many dimensions are the minimum to describe reality, and you are more likely to hear how much does a bar of soap cost, or this person said that and wasn't that so terrible. And I think consumerism and gossip is not so appealing to me, but the personalities of brain injured people are wonderful to behold. I just don't want to do it 24/7 if I can avoid it.
Right.
And I imagine maybe 100 years ago I might have been locked up as a brain injured person.
Right.
Medication is another part of my post-injury life. I take a half dozen pills each day to help keep me focused, help counter fatigue, and help get my injured brain to sleep at night. I haven't had a good night's sleep in over 15 years. Meds have improved my sleep, but finding the right pills has taken years of painful trial and error. Now on a good night, I wake up only once or twice. Because of my deficits, my ideal environment is one with as little stimulation as possible. A couple of years ago, my brother David introduced me to camping. Out in the woods is the perfect place for me. It's one of the few environments where I don't get easily distracted or immediately overstimulated. Everything else can stick on top.
By the time I had called, you know, they said that you had been in an accident and then that you were doing okay. They said, you know, he was in an accident, but he's fine now. And I said, you know, should I come home? And they said, no, there's no need for that. And no one ever used the word disabled, or nobody ever used nobody ever spoke about the fact that there might be some longer term or long term change. And you know, I'm sure that mom and dad probably didn't want to explore that idea very much. And you know, and for them, you know, each step that you would make towards recovery was probably a way that they were really they're probably really excited by that, and rightfully so. One of the curses I think that you have is that your injury really is, it's not like brain injury is invisible sometimes or usually, but I think that there are some that are more invisible than others, and yours is particularly invisible. It could be because, you know, when you got hit here instead of here, or it could be that the impact, if it was just a little more, or even, or a little less, or even just a little more, right, it would have had just, the implications might have just been totally, totally different. Right. So,
or if I was, like, I had immediate ambulance there, too, if I was lying there bleeding on a sidewalk for another 20 minutes or something. I
mean, right.
Yeah,
there's any number of variables. Yeah. And, you know, I don't know how they ultimately translate into how you experience life now, but they do, certainly, you know. Over the years, I've had a hard time distinguishing between what is you and your personality versus what is kind of the newer you post-injury because of the injury, you know, because...
I'm not sure I understand that.
Well, because there's a way in which... How I understand is that there's a way in which brain injury accentuates certain personality features.
Or de-accentuates.
Right. So, but I mean, you know, there's certain things that... certain traits that you had, but one, I guess what I'm saying is that there's ways in which things that I thought were probably more about your personality that later in past 3 years, I realized are probably more injury related than personality.
Nothing today, Michelle. I forgot other friends are here. Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Bye. I think the very essential thing is just the economic misery in which brain-injured people have been catapulted by a mere circumstance.
Right.
I mean, many of us have had educational or vocational careers and attainments of some considerable distinction.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are left trying to figure out how to live on too little money to afford us a decent apartment, much less a home and a car and what other people consider regular amenities of life.
On top of that too, being brain injured on top of being poverty stricken is like, you know, makes it all the more difficult. To be non-brain injured and deal with it is one thing, but to be brain injured and deal with it, it's doubly, triply, however much more difficult as well. So it's...
Yes, I certainly agree with you. I think there's less caviar and Dom Perignon on the table nowadays.
Hello.
Oh, wait a minute here.
What?
Come on in.
What do you mean, wait a minute?
I wasn't expecting the camera.
I'm missing a few pages here, because that's page 9. Let's see where the other pages, but he talks about...
Despite years of volunteer work and a post-injury college degree, Nani hasn't been able to find a job.
For all my talents, you know, it seems like what gets highlighted when I go on a job interview is my deficits. When I went into this one interview, I had one person sitting here and one person sitting here. You know, I tried to ask if they could both sit on the same side of the room so that I could read their lips or fill in, you know, what I miss by reading their lips.
And what'd they say?
And, no.
They said no.
They said no. When I walk into a job interview, they look at me and I look at just like them, and they figure that you have the same type of processing and cognition that they do. You know, so when you start asking for them to do things differently, you know, sometimes they perceive it as a threat, sometimes they perceive it that you want privileges, sometimes, you know, they make a judgment that, oh, I don't know if I want to employ her, she's going to always be asking for stuff.
So,
a lot of fruit and some sandwich stuff, but he'll do things like he'll put this in here, and he'll put the ice cream in the refrigerator instead of the freezer.
Movies, while they were making them, I mean, one of them might be like opening a door.
In addition to caring for herself, Nani also cares for her father, who has Alzheimer's.
Come in the gas stations for...
What I don't have is the advocacy for my life that you do. My mother had it for me. She was like a pit bull. Sorry, I shouldn't have used that. Sorry about that. Bulldog. I mean, she just
tenacity
that she never gave up. She was just like right on the front lines in these doctors' faces about the stuff that was going on in my life. And I've noticed that you have that same tenacity.
For the 25 years that I've been rehabilitating, about 13 of those years I've been homeless.
As a way of giving back to the disability community, Nani will sometimes act as the facilitator for support group meetings.
I just, you know, got scrappy and decided that I had been given a second chance to live. And I just decided that if it was possible, I would become an advocate. This is a place where I don't have to justify myself. I don't have to feel like I'm making excuses or asking for privileges. You know, I can talk about my head injury without people saying that I'm trying to have people feel sorry for me, because my life is my life. You know, I can't deny, you know, like being homeless. That's all part of who I am. And in fact, I wouldn't have been as effective as a counselor if I didn't know what it was like to live on the streets. What's it like having a hidden disability?
You have to tell everyone, and they don't understand. it gets tiring just telling people, because you look normal, but you're not acting right. And then you have to keep explaining to people what's wrong with you. And most
support groups fill an important role for survivors, and just knowing a community like this exists is important to remind survivors we're not facing our disability alone. But there's only so much a support group can do. We also need real changes in society so we survivors can get the care and support we need after our injuries. Accommodations need to be put in place that would make it easier for us to hold jobs, to help us negotiate demanding and high-stress appointments in public assistance offices, or to deal with overwhelming environments like airports and college campuses. But to begin a serious discussion about the accommodations we need, it seems we as survivors will have to educate society about our needs.
I always have problems with memory and organization, so it was a little bit challenging. I did lose my ticket. And I did get to the they issued me my boarding pass, and then I lost it, and then I couldn't remember where it was, and then they had to reissue me with another ticket. And I had to ring up last night and find out exactly what airline was I on, because I couldn't remember, and I couldn't remember where the piece of paper was that had my flight information on, and I couldn't remember what time it was that I was leaving. Wow. And
memory plays quite a role then.
Yeah.
And adjusting and
but other than that, it was all fine. Other than not being able to remember.
I met Mark when I was looking for a guest speaker for the support group. He's a brain injury survivor who received a PhD after his injury, and he's now a professor teaching disability studies. Mark's done important work researching the lives of brain injury survivors and how we, as survivors, can change the way we think about ourselves.
There is a great strength in the disability community. You know, what we're learning these days, the disability tragedy model's gone out the window. That's it from times past. What we have now is disability pride, disability cool, disability chic. You know, to think of brain injury as a source of pride is a revolutionary concept. It's so different from the medical model. To think I'm brain injured and I'm proud of it, that is turning the tables upside down.
Mark asked us to wait in the garage for a moment. He wanted to show us something to help illustrate his point.
This is a lot about brain injury. For me personally, I had a frontal lobe injury, and the frontal lobe affects your personality. Lots of people with frontal lobe injuries have disinhibition. One way disinhibition expresses itself is through anger. So lots of people who you'll talk to will have expressions of anger, maybe violent outbursts. But for me, one way my personality changed was I lost the capacity to be shy. Wally with his... Wally, sit. Rehab professionals always tell you about the negative parts about disinhibition. Disinhibition can cause people to say things immediately. But on the flip side, lots of people with brain injuries who have frontal lobe syndrome, if they have disinhibition, they'll be far more exuberant. Mm-hmm. Like they'll be... Mm-hmm. They can tend to be performers, those sort of things. Right. They can be... out. This is an area that's not really explored in rehab, because people think of deficits. People think of changes as deficits. Mm-hmm. Not what can they do as a result of it.
Brain injury pride. That's a completely different way to look at brain injury. to not focus what's been lost or to feel like less of a person because of it, but instead to take pride in who we've become after our injuries. But we need to do more than just think about ourselves differently. We also need the society we live in to be more aware of brain injury. I want to know how we as survivors can organize ourselves. Since every brain injury is different and has a unique set of needs, it's a challenge to organize brain injury survivors around a common goal, not to mention figure out our place in a wider disability rights movement.
Yeah.
To answer some of these questions, Mark suggested we meet with Zona Roberts at her home in Berkeley. Zona is the mother of the independent living pioneer and activist, Ed Roberts.
This was on, and I'm not sure what the year was or what rally it was, but some, well, wait a minute, does it say on the back? That would be very nice if it did. He had a charisma about him that he could, with his snapping brown eyes kind of, and his enthusiasm, and as I said, when he was going to high school, he didn't like to be out and have people look at him and stare at him. And then he decided if they were going to stare at him, he might as well be a star. And so he started looking at it that way, as long as it's going to happen.
After contracting polio while still in high school, Ed Roberts was paralyzed and spent most of his life in an iron lung. But he didn't let this stop him from becoming the first severely disabled student to enroll at UC Berkeley, and later, from becoming a key leader in what came to be known as the disability rights movement.
You know, seeing him speak different places, and if there'd be the kids in the wheelchairs who had multiple injuries, brain injuries along with paralysis and stuff, and he'd have them come up on the stage with him, and he has more inspired more kids and more people and their parents as a result to band together to do things and to become public with their disabilities and be a star.
Right.
You know, if that's what it takes, then be a star, if you can pull it together, and that's...
I like hearing things about organization, because working on this documentary and trying to get people together to schedule, you know, within a time frame and stuff, it's mm-hmm. challenging to organize brain injury people.
It's amazing how new the disability rights movement really is.
Yeah.
In that same spirit as people in wheelchairs fought for accessibility, maybe we, as brain injury survivors, need to fight for the accommodations that would benefit us.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, also, it's like...
You're going to force the issue, and that's good.
The thing of brain injury as brain injury, and then how much to identify with the disability community. Like, there's certainly benefits there, but then, like you were saying, too, that each has its own needs, and so there's a time for unity of sorts, and then there's a time for just individual... type of thing.
We in our hands hold our fate. If we don't stick together, if we don't advocate, if we don't build something that's much bigger than my little stay in hospital, if we don't say this was a really important thing, but sometimes the system let me down, and for the next person I've got to make sure this doesn't happen, then we're letting down the next person in the same bed that we were. And that person really has far more in common with you than you care to realize. And that person is your brother and sister, because they really are you. And you know, what we don't think about, what we're trained in society to think about is this: I'm not like the person who's down. I'm not like the person who's homeless. I'm not like the person who's psychotic. I'm not like the person who's epileptic or whatever. You know, I want to say the absolute opposite. I want to say to anybody who ever hears me, crazy, I'm crazy. Epileptic, I'm epileptic. Using a catheter, I'm using a catheter. Unable to breathe for yourself, I'm unable to breathe for yourself. Anything abject, anything disrespected, that's me. That's bed number two. That's bed number three. That's bed number four. That's us. That's our family. If we don't stick together, we live or die by that.